So good afternoon to all of you. In the next 25 minutes, I've been given the task to talk about renewable energy options for buildings. So you had already a series of lectures focusing on green buildings, focusing on passive. And so I'm going to touch upon the active renewable energy options. Okay, so the way we plan it, let's start with a set of questions. These are the questions that we're going to answer in this talk is, how much energy do we use in our house? And we'll try and do a simple quantification so that all of us live in houses. And so if we want to see how much energy we use, we can do this, and this is a simple number to calculate. Then we'll look at what is the end use pattern for the buildings. Then we ask the question, why opt for renewable energy at all? And then list out the different options, and then close with some examples and then challenges for renewable energy systems in buildings. So before we look at it, when you look at it from an energy systems point of view, we need to look at the energy that is available in nature, which is primary energy, and this could be your solar, it could be wind, but it could also be fossil fuels, it could be coal, oil, natural gas, and that goes through a series of sequence of steps and through energy conversion facilities to give you a secondary energy, which is refined oil or electricity, goes through transmission distribution system, and then you get the final energy that you pay for. The final energy that we pay for normally for our house will be maybe electricity and LPG, and then that goes to our equipment, and then you get the useful energy and the end use activity. So we may do, when we do the calculation, we can do the calculation at the point of the energy service, which is what we are interested in. That is, we want comfort conditions, we want heating, we want cooling, we want some motive power, we want illumination. And in order to do that, we are buying energy, which is final energy, or we are using some energy from nature, which is the primary energy. So at any of these levels, either the energy service or the final energy or the primary energy. So we'll calculate the final energy and the primary energy for a house. And so let's look at this. How would you calculate it? Let's say each house is paying an electricity bill. So take your electricity bill. I've taken a simple example of a house which does not have air conditioning, and say we are using 120 kilowatt hour per month. Okay. And depending on the number of people you have in the house and the amount of times that you do cooking, so you will have a certain amount of LPG uses. I am just assume, let's say, one cylinder per month. This is a reasonable assumption for a small family. And if you look at this, we can then take this and convert the numbers. Take that 120 kilowatt hour, and then you convert it into kilojoules and divide it by 1000 to get megajoules. So you get 432 megajoules per month. If you look at LPG, one cylinder has 14.2 kgs, and so multiply that by the energy content of LPG, and you get another about 600 megajoules. And so if you add these two up, you get essentially the energy use in your house, and you can just plug in your own numbers, and this is now the energy that you use, the final energy that you are getting. If you want to convert it in terms of primary energy, remember that the electricity that you are using has already taken much more in terms of primary energy, because you have a coal power plant facility and that has an efficiency. So we take this 432 divided by an approximate number of 30%. LPG also has some refining, and you know, from crude oil if you are getting it, but that efficiency is about 90%. So if you add it up, it comes to about 2100 megajoules per month. So you can immediately do the similar calculation for your own house, and then depending on the, so if I look at that, multiply it, and you get so many gigajoules, 25 gigajoules per year. Suppose it's a we have four people divided by the number of people, and this gives you immediately 6.3 gigajoules per capita per year. We'll just keep tab of this number, because I want to compare this number with what are the numbers for other country, other cities in the world. We can also look at what we are interested in all of this is, we are maybe interested in energy, but we are interested in the price that we pay for the energy. So typically, you will be, if you are talking 120 kilowatt hour, we are in the slab 100 to 300 kilowatt hour. The way most of our electricity is priced is, we have a slab system. If you use more per month and you are in a higher slab, the price of electricity is higher. So 100 to 300 kilowatt hour, roughly about 5 rupees per kilowatt hour. Multiply that, so that means we are getting about 7,000 rupees per year is what we are paying on electricity, and for LPG we are paying about 5,400 rupees. This is subsidized. So if you take it unsubsidized, it is about 10,800. So for energy, for this house that we talk of, we are paying 12,600 rupees per year, as compared to, and if it was unsubsidized, 18,000 rupees. We will look at this, this number is to be kept in mind, because when I am going to talk to you about renewables, we will see the same numbers for renewables, so that you can get a sense. We can't talk about energy without talking about emissions in today's world, every time we could look at. So you can immediately look at this, multiply the electricity by an emission factor. Now, emission factor depends on what kind of, how you generate your electricity. So if it's more of coal, then the emission factor will be higher. If it's more hydro, it will be lower. So for an average, for the Indian context, it's about 0.9 or 0.89 kgs. And LPG is about 65 kgs. You can multiply this and you immediately straight away get what is the amount of kg of CO2 per year and per person. And this is something that you can easily do for yourself. And you can see for your house, for your electricity and cooking, this is the amount of energy, this is the cost, and this is the CO2. And then we can, you can do the similar calculation for the other renewables that we talk about later. So if you look at this, this is from a global energy assessment, and you will see that the gigajoules per capita for different countries for residential uses, and you will see that this red part, a large part of these are cold countries, and a large part of the energy which is used is basically for space heating. And if you subtract, if you remove that and you look at the remaining part of it, then you see that we are somewhere over here when we talked of that 6.3 gigajoules per capita, but these are different kinds of numbers. So let's move on, and let's look at, in the Indian context, there is a study in Delhi, and you can see the end use electricity by different appliances. So you see that, you know, we are looking at cooking and lighting, and also there are other, you know, the television, refrigerators, air conditioning, and then there will be a different mix for summer and winter. So we need to understand these kind of appliance ownerships. Different countries also have different supply mixes. So if you look at India, for instance, it's something which you may surprise you, today our building energy use is predominantly renewables. And however, this is because it's predominantly for cooking, predominantly cooking by biomass, traditional renewables, very low efficiency. So if you look at primary energy supply, as people move up the energy chain and you go for more and more convenient fuels, this is going to get shifted, this biomass section is going to get shifted into kerosene or LPG or electricity, right? And so if you look at the mix of other countries, you will see that heating and electricity and natural gas, etc., all come in. So this is just to understand. So when we talk about the present situation for electricity and power generation, we are mainly thinking in terms of large centralized generation, which is going to supply you electricity through a grid. When we talk of future possibilities, we are also looking at each building having its own generation. We are thinking in terms of cogeneration, trigeneration, decentralized, distributed generation, and demand side management. So this is something that you have to keep in mind. It is not necessarily only the context that we have. So if we now talk about that building which has 120 kilowatt hour per month use, I have put down, based on that study, there's a World Bank report which has a study of appliances, and for those appliances with the ratings, we have built up for each of these appliances end use curve, and the total load profile, as you can see, the load is not constant, and you have to meet the peak. Most of the peak is basically in the evening and night time. So for this building, we have this requirement is about 0.4 kilowatt peak, and on an average we are requiring for this house, it's a non-air conditioned house, remember, we are talking of 0.16, about 160 watt is the average through the day. And keep these numbers in mind, because I am going to now design, we'll look at a PV design for the same kind of building. So before we do that, let's now look at what is the, what are the motivations, why should we opt for renewable energy? One motivation, fossil fuel prices are increasing, and most of the places in India we have energy shortages, we have electricity shortages. You all know that the US dollar is going, you know, we started with 45 and now it's like 64. So energy security, when you look at the amount of money we are using to pay for our oil bill, energy security means that if we can have control over the energy that we are using and we can have an uninterrupted supply, which means that we, again, renewables offers you that option. The most predominant driver today is greenhouse gas emissions, global warming and climate change. So even if we have fossil fuels, the overall CO2 emissions that are caused by fossil fuels implies that we cannot continue to have our future energy systems only be fossil fuel based. Also, there have been and are continuing to, we are continuing to have significant improvements in renewable energy. Costs are decreasing, there is a very steep learning curve, and we anticipate and expect that renewables are going to increasingly become more and more cost effective. So that's, these are the reasons why we should be looking in for renewable energy. Now, there are a variety of renewable energy options, and we will touch upon a few of them, because currently based on present technology, these are the ones which are likely to be suitable for buildings. So we look at solar, we look at solar thermal, solar photovoltaic, we look at wind, we can have ocean thermal energy for large scale centralized, we look at some biomass, geothermal, small hydro, wave energy and tidal. And of these, in the context of buildings, the ones that I shortlist for the options are solar. We can go for solar and solar photovoltaics for generating electricity, solar thermal for space heating and for cooking and water heating. We'll look at biomass, could be used for water heating, could be used for space heating, but biomass predominantly we will look at for cooking. Wind could be for electricity, again electricity then could be used for all electricity, also appliances. Geothermal, cost effective solution in many cases for space heating and space cooling. And of course, this is not an exhaustive list, you can think of various others, but these are in today's technology, in my opinion, these are the ones which are most near cost effectiveness. So let's start with solar and solar photovoltaics, and these are some pictures taken from the web of solar PV modules, and I'm sure many, most of you have seen some of these, and you have different kinds of products. For instance, lighting products, these are of course using CFLs, and now you have solar lanterns using the LEDs, and you can have solar home systems and solar power supplies. And this is a installation, for instance, a 5 kilowatt peak installation at a small village on the way from Mumbai to Pune. At Rajmachi village, it's a 5 kilowatt peak solar system. This is a picture of a passive house with zero energy building, and you can see the solar PV modules on the side. I'm going to quickly go through these. And these are some schematics of how you can connect your grid connected systems. And there are several such things, if you, you can just look at these systems, and many of these systems are functional. This is one of the, you can see the PV integrated into a building, it's the CII building at Hyderabad. So and different concepts, and you can look at the European Union, and you have different kinds of images of building integrated photovoltaics which are there. At IISc Bangalore, they have a BIPV lab, and they put a panel of about 5 kilowatt peak, and they have got, this paper reports some of the results that you have from this BIPV. So this is actually integrated along in with the roof, and this is the glass panel which we are looking at, and you can see this is the schematic of that structure. And you can of course see that the output of this varies over the year, and you have a DC output, and then the AC, there is a conversion loss efficiency, and this details are there in the paper in the reference which is there. So one of the challenges that we have is the solar insulation, the supply is not constant, and typically over the day when you see, this is the time when you have the requirement where you have the supply. The load that we had, we saw that that has a different kind of requirement. So then unless you have a grid connect, if you are going to have an isolated system, then you are thinking in terms of batteries and storage, which is again costly. And so that is the, and of course also there is a seasonal variation. So for instance, if you look at Mumbai, you can see that with different months, during the monsoon months, the solar insulation is a little less than the other months. So now let us look at that same installation that we talked of, 120 kilowatt hour per month, and we want to design for that system. Let us see what are the panels that we can choose. So I have chosen a panel which is a BP3125 panel, and this is the current versus voltage curve for this. Peak rating is 125 watts. So we choose 10 of these panels, and that would be, if you look at the energy under the area under the curve along with the battery and the some efficiencies assumed, that is enough for meeting the requirement that we had shown. We also take a battery, lead acid battery of 4 kilowatt hour, and for this system then, this is my solar generation. If you can see this, this is the solar generation. Of course, the peak of the solar generation, as I said, was 1.2 kilowatt peak rating, and of course this is for a particular insulation, so the kilowatt rating is little less. And then for that, this is the load, and then you have some of, sometimes the load will be coming from the battery. You have a battery charging and battery discharging, and you can take this from me, but you can cross check it. You can take this area under the curve is equal to this area. So now let us look at, when you do this approximately with the numbers that you can have, this system is going to cost, the PV modules will cost about 70,000 rupees. Battery will cost, depending on the rating, 25 to 30,000, I have taken 30,000, and the balance of system and the inverters, controllers, another 30,000. So we are talking of a total approximate cost of 1.3 lakhs. And the annual savings of about 7,200, and that is the reason why all of us do not have PV powering our homes. And however, many parts of the world, and even India is proposing that, that we all often we induce, because we have a preferential tariff. So even if you just look at this and you think in terms of a preferential tariff of 15 rupees per kilowatt hour. Now the many parts of the world, the tariff for PV based electricity is even higher than this. So even if you just look at that and you say that we have grid buyback and net metering. Grid buyback and net metering means that I can take from the grid whenever I want, and I can supply back to the grid whenever I want. And the advantage then is I can get rid of my battery. So that will reduce your cost, and now your cost is only about a lakh. And now your saving, annual saving is about 21,600 with a 15 rupees per kilowatt hour. So the payback period is 4 to 5 years, which is reasonable. And so if you have the right kind of conditions, even now it is at the margin. And then if you look at some of the malls or some of the other places where your electricity price is even higher, then and PV costs are going down. So in future you can think in terms of looking at some of these things. The other technology currently, which I mean many of you are from Bangalore or from Pune, you will see almost everywhere there are solar water heaters, and this is something where we are looking at most of the water requirements that we have are at relatively low temperatures. So even flat plate or evacuated tube collectors, you will see that it pays back for itself if you are replacing electricity for in about 3 years or so at today's prices. So even without any subsidies, this is something that is viable, and this can be used. Solar cooking is something which is potentially possible, but not the problem is that we need to then change our cooking habits. So flat plate, sunbox cookers, but the problem is then you will not be able to do deep frying and several of the other things that you could not be able to do. On the other hand, if you have concentration, for instance, you have the Scheffler, and then you concentrate it, then you will see incidentally this image of the kitchen. This is actually a solar kitchen, okay? So there's no flame there, and so this can enable a wide variety of cooking. And the problem is this is Ajay Chandrak's innovation, where he actually, even in a household with a balcony, you can just put this concentrator there and you can have a pressure cooker putting that. So based on this, this kind of cooking can be a supplementary cooking. However, for institutions and community kitchens, you can look at concentration and steam, and you can have steam based cooking, and that could be almost like a viable option. The other option is when we look at biomass, and we are talking of biomass gasifiers, we need to look at getting more convenient and LPG kind of quality of flame. And for that, we have a number of designs of biomass micro gasifiers and biomass gasifier cook stoves. And these typically will cost you, of course, will cost you initially 2000 to 4000 rupees. And there have been different kinds of schemes, and you can see the flames which we are talking of. These flames are as good in terms of the density. We are talking of efficiencies of conversion of the order of 50%, and the LPG is about 60-65%. So this is technically, these are possible. Some of these are commercial. For instance, this is a design which was ISC was involved, and BP. And there's a company which is now looking at it, Urja. This has a fan in it, and they are also looking at here a fuel chain where you take biomass and you pelletize, and these biomass pellets, this will come to about 1/5 the cost of your LPG. There is a small initial model had lead acid battery. Now there is a nickel cadmium battery which is used in these. There is another interesting, it's a award-winning innovation. It's a BioLite stove, and the idea in this is that the flue gases, the products of combustion which are here, you have a thermoelectric generator, and that drives a fan that also provides for you an option where you can have an LED light, or you can charge your mobile phone. And in terms of cost, still, they are talking of something of the order of about $70 price, but there are ways in which. So, you can see this is an active area, and this is something which can also be thought of. And nearer home in the in Pune, there is an association called ARTI, Appropriate Rural Technology Institute, and they have these biomass gasifier stoves. They also have, you know, when you look at vegetable kitchen waste, you can use that kitchen waste to give you biogas, and you can run that. And so you have two digesters. One is possibly on a rooftop, and one could be actually even on, they have a small unit which can even be put on a small balcony. And this is another option which is there. Geothermal, of course, we can look at just the ground heat pump or heat cooling, but there are also places where you can use the heat which is available for cooking. And so this is basically the geothermal map of the Indian context. And we can think in terms of integration of that geothermal with building integrated PV. And you can look at building integrated PV, and then heat recovery, and then ducting and system of light. So a geothermal heat pump, typically very common in many of the European and US countries. We are talking of small delta T's, so you can use the ground as a source of heat, and in the Indian context, you can use the ground as a source of putting in your air conditioning system. Instead of having the condenser, you can put that back into the ground, and then your overall efficiencies will improve. And now there are some companies who are in this space. In the case of wind, Professor Swati talked about that large building with wind machines. You can have also small wind machines. And this is the Auroville's wind generator, 2 kilowatt peak rating, and it can be put adjacent to the building. Then you can have, the interesting thing is wind and solar, the resources are actually complementary. So normally when you have high wind, you have low sun, and low sun, high. So there is, if you combine wind and PV, then the overall ratings will be, so there is a synergy in that. And currently, if you want to do this, you know, you want to have a 5 kilowatt or a 10 kilowatt hybrid system, the government gives you quite a bit of subsidy. So you can get actually a 10 kilowatt system for about 2.5 lakhs or so. And I think about 70% is subsidized, and that's another option. Okay, so I've come to the closing of this lecture. I have given you a quick overview of the different kinds of renewable energy options that are possible for buildings. What are the challenges and what does the future hold in store for us? We have, there's significant scope for technology development in all of this, technology development and cost reduction. When you do renewables in building, the first few things that you have to do is integrate the demand side management. First, see that can you reduce your loads. So whether it is by passive or it is by more efficient systems, reduce your loads, look at efficiency, demand side management, and then passive, then configure the active systems for your. And then the main challenge here is to match your supply and demand. And storage is right now costly, so cost effective storage is going to be another challenge for the future. There is an issue of decentralized and centralization. Overall, our grids, our energy supply systems, our society is all gone towards a centralized kind of model. Many of the things that we are looking at for buildings imply a decentralized model, and we may even go back to DC. Right now all our appliances are AC, so we take that PV, the calculation that I talked of, PV, then take it to an inverter, then get it to AC, and then have the devices running on AC, but we can think in terms of having a DC grid. In the interim, there will be hybridization, so you are going to have renewables and fossil, and then you have to have controls. We are talking of smart metering, microgrids, all of this, the cost angle will come in. We can redesign the houses for renewables, and this is a challenge for all the architecture people, because you can rethink the way you design your house so that you integrate renewables into it. And finally, the whole thing is future systems are not going to look like what exists today. So there is scope for R&D and innovation, and of course there has to be policy support to sort of make this happen. Just want to acknowledge some people who've helped me in preparing this presentation. I'll end with a just quotation from an American philosopher, writer, poet, Henry David Thoreau, who said, "What is the use of a house if you haven't got a tolerable planet to put it on?" So what we need to think of when we look at renewables is how do we make the houses that facilitate a tolerable planet, okay? And so there are a number of references. I've tried to go through several things, but I've quickly gone over it, and you can go get a lot of details from these two pages of references. Okay, thank you all.